Molly Carl, and I'm the director, editor of HowlRound. I work with, I was one of the curators of the festival, along with, with my colleagues, David Dower, Rob Orchard, Mayan Wang, and Mark Russell from Under the Radar, who I don't see here now, but, and I just got out of a stuck elevator for 10 minutes. And it was like scary, stuck, so I feel all, and then I worked on a play called Stuck Elevator, and so now I feel like it's all kind of coming together for me. So I have a deeper dramaturgical sense of the play as a result, yes, right? We are in day something of the TNT Fest. We started on Friday. We got up to full speed yesterday, had our first workshop yesterday. The idea of the Next Thing Festival is to feature both the product, but also, more importantly, the process and the conversation. So trying to get a sense of the whole of a conversation around the work. And so this week we're not only presenting shows, as you know, but we're having these workshops where we're featuring artists either who are either in the festival or part of, are part of the New England Foundation for the Arts conversation of Devise Theater. And so we've kind of partnered with New England Foundation of the Arts to bring some companies who are in town and have dialogues between companies who are here performing in the festival. So yesterday's conversation was, I just thought, terrific between the two companies to see how they work differently and where were the points of overlap. And so we'll have that same opportunity today. And so we're going to start off with the New York City Players. And I have a little bit of an intro because Richard Maxwell's not here, so I'm just going to say the intro. And we are lucky to have with us, where'd you guys go? Oh, there we go. Jay Smith, and then we have Christina Masciotti, the playwright, and Linda Mancini. So the two actors for the performance and the playwright, and then their general managers here too, O'Hagan, yes. So, and the New York City Players is an experimental theater company based based in New York. Until Vision Disturbance first happened in 2010, the company produced plays written and directed by Richard Maxwell, and had established a repertoire of work that was associated with him. Vision Disturbance was the first time that Maxwell had worked with a living early career playwright, Christina. This collaboration was successful in a number of ways and began to establish NYCP as a company not just associated with one artist, but a community of artists that support the work of experimental writer-directors with a distinct voice. The company's experience with Vision Disturbance has led to the creation of a new program called American Playwrights Division. This is a residency program curated by Maxwell, offered to one early career playwright who directs her own work per year. And then because Richard couldn't be here, he wanted to send a thought, and so I'm gonna read that thought. I think the main reason Christina and I worked so well together is that we are both writers. Christina cares about being incredibly accurate about what the characters say and representing what she hears. I also write like that. And I think if this piece was overtly lyrical or drew attention to the poetry, then it wouldn't have worked as well. Because we both care about accuracy and specificity, and because I am used to editing as I direct, we were able to edit the play together. So we're gonna do pretty much what we did yesterday. For those of you who are here, we're gonna have 40 or so minutes from the New York City Players. Then we're gonna work with then the LA Poverty Department is gonna do, LAPD is gonna do their thing, and then we'll leave 20 minutes or so for questions from the group. So take it away.
Thanks, that was so nice, thank you. You had no idea.
I'm Linda, this is Jay, and Christina, our playwright. And I think we'll start with getting everybody up, if that's okay, onto the stage. If you think your shoes will scuff up the floor, we'll ask you to take them off, but if you don't think so, it'll be fine. Let's just get into a circle. Wow, so many.
Some light.
Am I supposed to
be? Yeah, you can stand there.
There's big space here, we can close it up.
And we'll try this one, even if we can. Wow, it's a nice big group, it's great. We'll just start off with what we call an awareness exercise. You may know it or may not. We're going to go through the alphabet. We're going to start with A. One person will say A, and another one person will say B, and another one person will say C. And if more than one people say the same letter, we'll start over again. Okay? So let's see if you can come a little closer to me just so people over there can have a look. So I will start. A.
B.
C.
D.
Okay, let's go back. Anyone can start now.
A.
B. B.
Start
A.
Again.
B.
C.
D.
B.
F. G.
H.
I.
J.
K.
L.
M.
N.
O.
R.
S.
T.
Wow, that was good. Go back to the beginning. Very good.
A.
B.
C.
D.
E.
F.
G. H.
I.
J.
K.
M.
N.
Okay.
A.
B.
C. D.
E.
F.
G.
H.
I.
K.
K.
F.
M.
R.
Yes.
G.
No.
V.
W.
X.
I.
Z.
Thank you. I think we'll move on, right? Yeah, this is just, you know, it's really, that was great. Great listening. And it's really, you know, it's more of a complete body listening, you know, than an audio thing. And that was wonderful. And we really do that a lot with the work that we do. So everybody can sit down and why don't we go sit that way? I mean, you can sit on the floor or in the seats. But let's just keep this center area a little open without any seating. Okay, if you will. Thanks. Huh? Yeah, you're sitting over here. Why don't you scoot over on the side here, and you'll see why in a minute. Do we have a piece of paper?
Christina has it.
Linda.
Okay. So this is a very simple exercise. I'm going to give... I'll show you the movements, okay? I think six movements. First thing I'm gonna ask you to do, I'm gonna leave this here. Let's see if that works. So, probably here. So, first thing you do, I'm gonna ask you to come up one by one, okay? Won't be able to go through everyone, I don't think, because we'd like to do a few different things, so a little sampling, but first thing will be to lie down. Probably the closest to the wall you can, okay? Second thing is to stand. Third thing is to take three steps. Fourth is to pick up the piece of paper. Fifth is to throw it, okay? And you're not, we're pretty close here to people, so it's not, the intention is not to throw at any particular person. You know, so that's why maybe, what's your name?
Oh, Leslie.
Leslie, why don't you sit over there just so you don't get hit, okay?
Okay.
And maybe, yeah, thanks, we'll just move over.
You threw it at me.
I threw it at you. Well, I didn't, actually. I threw in that direction. So, let's just start with that. Can we have one volunteer? I'll go through it again. Lie down, stand up, three steps, pick up the paper, throw it. Okay?
Yeah, I think it might be better because you're so tall. Just try and go a little further back.
Right here?
Yeah, and I'll move this up for you. Okay. Now, if you were given a choice to categorize this as happy or sad, what would you choose?
Happy.
Any others?
Based on how he did
just
it? Or
just what he did.
I would say sad.
Sad.
I think I would say sad.
Yeah.
Sad.
Yeah. Why? Now, we're not judging, okay? We're just seeing what it's what the movements are saying to you, all right?
Whatever.
Okay, but that's not, is that happy or sad? That's the question, happy or sad. You said
tempo.
Tempo. Okay. Anyone else, happy or sad?
I said sad, the same tempo.
Any of the happy people have anything to say?
The facial expression was happy.
Okay.
And the fact that he sort of blurred each of the movements into the, it wasn't like, when you did it, it was very specific, like stand up, then three steps, then toss, whereas this one it was sort of blurred, so it felt like there was a movement through it. Which
All right. Well, why not, can we ask you to do it again?
Yeah, sure.
Lie down, stand up, three steps, throw.
Should I have a really, really big smile on my face?
It's just all we're asking you to do is lie down, stand up, three steps, and throw.
Sure.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
And don't hit the wall. That's good. And if you think that was that paper too close, you want me to move it further?
It's fine. No,
good?
It's
okay.
Good.
Good. Happy or sad?
Sad.
It's just to the new, like if you go new, there's a spectrum. So like from neutral, it's just for me, it's like going to sad.
Like to the sad.
But not all the way.
Okay. All right. Anyone else?
Happy.
Yeah. Happy?
He was happy because he was out and out.
Okay.
As opposed to down.
All right. Anyone else?
There was kind of a slowness and a sluggishness to the way he moved, which is what why I said sad.
Okay. Great. Thank you very much. Thank you. What's your name?
Josh.
Josh. Thanks, Josh. Okay, can we have someone else? Lie down, stand, three steps, and throw, right? Okay. What's your name?
Noelle.
Noelle. Relaxed or nervous? Okay, relaxed. Anybody? Why?
I thought her steps had more of a glide to them than a stopping, starting.
Okay.
The glide felt relaxed.
Any nervous people?
I thought the steps were short, and that's why they were nervous.
Uh-huh.
Very deliberate.
Adjusting of clothing makes it me sense nervousness.
Uh-huh. Was there adjusting of clothing during?
At the end. At the end.
Oh, at the end. Right, I didn't see that. Great. Yeah. Can I go one more time?
Sure.
Okay. Relaxed or nervous?
Relaxed.
Oh, this is a disagreement. Relaxed people, anything you want to say?
So
So it, when she threw it, her eyes kind of followed. It was kind of like this.
Uh-huh.
Releasing the neck a little bit.
The steps were very nervous. And
uh-huh.
Very jerky.
Okay.
I read them as confident.
Relaxed or nervous.
I know, but.
Uh-huh. Okay, no, I'm teasing. That's good. Thank you very much. Thank you. Someone else? Oh, come on, it's fun. Okay.
Relax.
What's your name?
Anna.
Hi, Anna.
Same thing?
Yeah, same thing. Very simple. Very simple coffee. Lie down, stand, three steps, throw. Okay. Urban or suburban?
Urban.
Urban people, have anything to say?
The way she's throwing.
Determined.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
No nonsense, it was all.
And that's urban? Okay. Suburban? Any suburban people?
I would say suburban from that kind of underhand or passive mm-hmm. throw.
Uh-huh.
Judging the suburban folly.
It's an urban crowd.
You want to try it again?
She looked cheerful, which seemed urban. Reveals my life.
Urban or suburban?
Urban.
Urban. Urban. Urban.
Suburban.
Suburban. Suburban.
Urban. 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 The lack of eye contact feels urban to
yeah.
me.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. She's down most of the time.
The dismissiveness for me felt urban.
Yeah.
I think the sense that that nothing could harm her on the path getting up to the idyllic throw of the paper, you know, there could have been a tire swinging in the background. I haven't seen the city that much.
The idyllic.
That's suburban, obviously.
Yes. Yeah, I don't, not to read too much into it, but that's what we're doing. So the kind of end, like Noelle was saying, the dismissiveness seemed almost like a slap in the face of authority, sort of. It wasn't like a regular old baseball. It was kind of a, you go get it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. If
there was something,
the
yeah.
authority was a strange thing in there.
Okay. So what we're after here, to communicate, we're kind of after nothing, you know? What we're looking for is what we saw here. No consensus. That's what we're looking for. So we're gonna keep going. Okay, another volunteer? Yeah, we didn't meet earlier. Hi. Business or casual?
Casual.
Why?
She turned her back on us. Casual.
But I think okay. the awkwardness of the way that she had to turn felt very business. Like there was something about the way that it was like it didn't feel like.
Didn't feel casual.
It didn't feel casual at all. It felt like it was like
mm-hmm.
like a awareness of what you were doing. It felt business.
Okay, can we have another volunteer? How are we doing?
You're good.
Okay. We want to do one more.
Yeah, no, you've got like a solid.
left, right?
Left.
Okay.
Yes.
All right, let's do one more before we go on.
Go ahead.
It is a casual.
Business.
Casual.
Why? Casual? Why?
Throw was like.
Why weren't you?
The throw was.
Yeah.
Like,
expression. Business?
She was just all about getting it done.
Getting it done. Okay. So this, thank you so much. Thank you. So we do a lot of this when we're starting a new project, just to get ourselves warm. How many of you saw the show last night? Oh, great. So we're trying to get to that point where it's a very difficult thing, where we're not imposing one particular tone onto the audience. So what we work on a lot is to be aware of who is with us and be with an audience. So we have a lot of contact. You know, we always contact with the audience, and we're making sure in what we do or what we're told to say that we create an open enough situation where an audience can interpret what it is that we're saying for their own, for themselves. And it's a really hard thing to do because we're human, right? And we have a whole social a vernacular, even like physical, that we're very used to and that we take for granted. And what you did here was really noticed a lot of things. You noticed movements, very small movements, and tones, and that's something that the audience sees. So that's that. Thank you for that. We could go on, but we're going to move on to one other exercise just because we have you for a short period of time, Christina.
So this other exercise, we're going to ask volunteers to take 2 minutes, stand up here, and do whatever you want for those 2 minutes. It can be speaking, not speaking, but it's just the limit is 2 minutes. I need a...
Thank you.
Ding, ding.
Thank you.
I'm curious, why do you think we might do this exercise? Is there anything that you thought could be useful about something like this?
What holds the tension?
What holds the tension?
The power of being present.
In the audience and on stage, or just when you're in front of people?
Both.
Yeah. Both. And anyone who did it, did it?
2 minutes is an awful long time. It seems shorter.
Yeah.
If you don't experience it.
Yeah. It's kind of the perfect amount of time maybe you have something in mind that you might want to do, and then you've done it, and then you still have all this time to do it. What were moments that were interesting from what you saw?
This person next to me was just standing there and looking out at the audience and moving his head slightly. Mm-hmm. He just seemed to be totally, totally there.
Uh-huh. Yeah?
Well, when he was up there, there was this sense of anticipation, like he's always about to speak or say something.
Yeah.
I liked the moment where I think it was you found that the wall moved and went, oh! So real.
Right. You didn't hear that, sorry. The moment where?
The moment when the girl found that the wall moved, oh. It felt really authentic. So it was a real reaction.
Uh-huh. I enjoyed it. Sorry.
It was interesting how some people seemed to totally embrace, I am doing this in front of an audience, and you let that really inform what you were doing. And some people tried to pretend they weren't there, but you could tell they were still aware. And some people seemed to be much better at just, I am here, and I don't care what you guys are doing. It was interesting to see those different levels in different people.
Mm-hmm.
What were you going to say?
I was going to say, I enjoyed the moment when she was standing over here and took in the whole space. I suddenly was aware of the entire space.
I enjoyed the moment of despair that we saw a couple times when people realized that what they'd gone up there to do wasn't going to sustain them. It was just like, and it kept happening, and I really enjoyed that. Yeah, like all of a sudden I was like, oh,
yeah,
okay.
Everything was possible.
Right.
Using the space, like, even just from the beginning, like I didn't notice the whole theater behind until one person was there and the first person was standing, and then I got this depth of field and use of space, mm-hmm. going behind.
Yeah, the space is so well defined that it almost makes anything interesting. And you find yourself, the real drama I find myself watching is how are people going to respond to this sort of fairly simple demand, and what does it tell us about who they are and their personalities. So I found myself imposing my own sort of dramatic narrative on just basically the assignment and how people responded to it.
Uh-huh.
From being inside of it, I would have done less.
But what?
From being inside of it, I would have done less.
Yeah, I've seen this so many times, and with a lot of professional actors. I've seen them get out and like walk on their hands and see the pressure to perform and the tension between what you want to do, what you think they want to see. Mm-hmm. So, uh-huh.
It's just that one moment, the girl who was doing all the exercises,
uh-huh.
at the moment she was standing next to the wall, half behind it, and she completely disappeared in
yeah.
the space. She was very quiet, and I didn't even know she was there anymore for a few seconds, and I thought that was really interesting.
Yeah. Okay, I think our time's up.
Oh.
It was great.
Thank you.
Very, very revealing about the show last night. Do you know?
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
You can. They'll be around for questions after.
Yeah, they're going to be around for questions. Yeah, you bet. And so next up, Los Angeles Poverty Department, and it's John Malpede. And I know I'm going to say it kind of wrong, but close, Adiette Browers.
It's very
close enough, yes. All right. So, and so you guys are, 40, 45 minutes or whatever. You can do your thing.
We're gonna have a 15-second consult. Okay, so Los Angeles Poverty Department is a theater based in LA. We work with people living in a neighborhood known as Skid Row, which is a very special neighborhood. It's the one place where you can actually run into people on the street because no one has a car. And so it's the poorest neighborhood in Los Angeles, but it has a real vibrancy of its own. And consequently, I don't know, it struck, even though I've done many workshops like this in my lifetime, it seemed really weird, this notion of doing a workshop with people who I don't know, don't have a clue about for, 45 minutes, And then it seemed like this whole workshop form is like a really weird thing, because you can tell people to do stuff and they just do it. it's really good, So nevertheless, giving into that, I'm going to tell you what to do and you're going to do it. So I think we everybody who is willing has to stand up, and we're going to, all use the space. And because there's so many people, I think we should use the space here. The stairs are over there. Since we're all doing that together, the empty space that you're moving to isn't going to be there by the time you come back together. So you're continually readjusting until further notice. Better, really. Yeah, and these empty walls. Thank you. And let's fill just the center section equally. So everybody in from the outside, we're just filling the center section equally.
Please.
Come on back behind the Iron Curtain. So there might have been a lot to do while walking, but now you can take another minute or two to comfort this baby that is somehow another incarnation of you. Yeah, so take a minute to really, be with yourself in this sense. And really let that enter your body so you can tell what's happened. Keeping that going, let's just continue to keep that going, but half the people go around that side of the room and half the people over here. So then one at a time, we're just going to have people go, one person here go across to here, one person, then the next, someone from over here goes across, so that everyone goes across, and you're going across with this, you might as well just maintain the sense of being comforted, being protected, whatever's going on with you. Let's just do that one person at a time. Okay, we don't have to do it. Morgan's with the baby, that's cool. We can let go of the baby and just walk with don't drop the baby. Over here, you're just walking by yourself. So what was an external thing is now just you. good, more than one person. One and a half persons. Keep going, and you're walking. This time, now you can change a little bit. You're walking on the top of your game. You're on the absolute top of your game. Keep going. You're on the top of your game. Somebody from over here.
Keep going.
Keep going. Yeah, you're on the top of your game still. But a little concern about something or another is creeping in.
Creeping in?
A little concern about something or another is creeping in. Some like weird little irritation to the being on the top of the game. The smallest little itch. That concern is actually getting a little bit bigger, but you don't want to show it. So you're on the top of your game, but this concern is getting a little bit bigger now. Started out like a pea, now it's like a ping pong ball. Start out like a pea. It was like a ping pong ball. Keep going. You're on the top of your game. You don't want to show it because your head is as big as a basketball. Keep going. I mean, you're not showing it, but you are like totally out of control. You know, your head is as big as a basketball. You can't think straight. 500 pounds, your head is pounding. So now keep going with it. Now with it, you know, the basketball has popped. I mean, without making a big deal out of it, you're just, you know, you're just not trying to hide it behind your being on top of your game anymore. It's just there. You're just not on top of your game. Sorry. Okay, keep going. Just keep going with that. Without shifting gears, just keep going without you know, shifting gears. Be with that, and gradually you're gonna go from being out of control, showing it or whatever, to finding back or being protected like you were in the beginning. But in, you know, in real time, not by coercing it, but just letting it happen. So it helps to breathe. Really looking for, you know, a change in your internal weather from, you know, being overwhelmed to being able to be comfortable with yourself. One more time, let's keep going and go from there to being on the top of your game yet again. So keep going. So again, you're not just like jumping into something else, you're kind of being like, how you can definitely get it.
Thank you.
Okay. Cool. So let's stop in a minute. We're going to form two circles. I guess one on that side of the wall and one on this side of the wall. And Henriette, I think, is going to come back, and she's going to be on one side of the wall with somebody. But what we're going to do, we're going to be in a circle, and we're going to do something where two people are going to be talking at the same time. It's not a dialogue. It's as if you know, you're just talking in front of you, and then that person next to you is talking. So the one thing you want to do is sort of like balance your voices in some sense, but it's not about having a conversation. It's like two monologues happening simultaneously, you know. And the subject is like anything that's happened in the last 20 minutes. So you're talking, the person next to you is talking. At a certain point, Henriette on one side of the wall, me on the other side of the wall, saying, okay, you're out, you're in, you know. Sometimes that's brutal because it's like just when you don't have anything else to say, that sounds really interesting to have you say some more stuff. Yeah. So that's what we're going to do, okay? So half the people over there, this group over here. So Nick, why don't you two start and go around this way? So again, you're not looking at one another. You're just talking generally. It's like you're driving. Your relationship to the other person is you're driving the car down the street. The other person is the squirrel that runs in front of your car. You like alter what you're doing to incorporate the squirrel's not getting run over, and then you can keep going. No, there is no. The situation is you're talking about your experience in the last 20 minutes. Anything about that, or you know, and you're both just talking about it to everyone. But the other person's role is to be the unexpected thing that maybe influences what you're doing. But don't worry about it too much.
Walking around through the little space, trying to make yourself
better.
So I just had to turn a lot.
Okay, Nick is out, you're in, and you're in.
I was going to go up and call my grandma, so I was going to go up here and and I call my grandma to have a conversation with her. And I figure, like, what a better way to spend this workshop than having a nice 2-minute conversation with my grandma? And also, 2 minutes on the phone, I feel like I can go by a lot faster than anywhere else.
Actually, just gonna keep going louder and faster, so I'll just keep my little quiet.
So apparently, I was worried I was gonna talk like too softly right now. And
so when we were running around the space, was thinking, I don't know, almost mathematically about it, that there's a distance, there was a physical distance between all of us.
And
yet there was a distance that had to be covered by our bodies, which were being blocked by the rows of the chairs and the
okay, great, next person.
The chairs.
I find that physical exercise is the only way to truly understand who you are as a person.
I had to go out and around
physically exercise
and until I got warmed up. Like then I could go over
better,
the backs of the chairs.
And while you
then the space,
exercise, you
the dimensions of the space change at that point because instead of everything having
because
to be
when you're
out
in your own
and
space,
up, back in again,
that's when you can
now
really
I can
truly
move
think.
Up and down.
You can only find that space when you are that tired.
At that point,
drawn.
Then
there's
then
really
the
no
exercise
other way.
Changed.
Everything else
were, like,
is just bullshit.
Collapsing
like everything else,
and
doesn't really matter.
Wondered,
it's just like it's
we're
all
almost like
psychological
heating up because we're together.
When
we're
you're not
bouncing
doing something
off
physically
other,
with your life, what are you doing? How do you know yourself? If you can't
when you heat up,
physically challenge yourself.
There's more
every day.
Pressure, and not like a pressure to perform, but just like oh,
people
we're
get
suddenly
the,
interacting
get the,
every few seconds
get through
instead
their day
of interacting every 20 seconds
pushing themselves
or 5 seconds.
Nobody wants to do that anymore. Nobody wants to actually
and I wondered
get
if we were just
going to
compress down
everybody
into
wants to
this
just sit there
little space.
Think about you know, why they
then it was kind of funny
want
because,
to do what they want to do.
When
they
close your eyes, I sort of, I didn't
so why
hear
should we
question. Like, oh, are we now going to be running around
really want to just
the space with our eyes closed? And
not
like,
think
sure
about
really
others all the time. Is that what
you
want to understand?
Next person.
So we can understand each other? We should understand ourselves first before we understand each other. No,
what they were
we should
say.
Understand each other first. And I think that if
and,
you would exercise once in a while,
I was looking at the three of us and it seemed that
we
might have
we look
East European
descent.
Yeah,
we could be. I think we all know. Yeah, we could all be relatives. Yeah, this guy sounds like a grandpa. It's weird.
I think somebody has stolen my top.
Yeah, Eastern Europeans, they
so, and,
okay, next person.
I don't know how I'm going to top this.
And,
Last 20 minutes have been pretty interesting. Just trying to figure out the whole thing. I'm
confused.
I'm realizing maybe there isn't anything other than really funny and amusing.
I'm wondering when I'm going to have to stop.
Yeah, running around. I've been pretty winded. I'm just hoping I wasn't going to be able to run into anybody.
Really nice.
Kind of keep my eyes on the ground.
And it feels like I've lost the
attention. Was somebody right there.
I wonder
turned
how
right back around.
Without raising the volume.
It's a challenge getting into tighter and tighter spaces. I was hoping to make it to the mezzanine, but I wasn't able to do that.
I think it's very interesting.
You know, it's all right. And then all of a sudden we have to kind of just stop and stand there. And I was just
talk about
to kind of
each other's origins. I don't think that's that interesting.
But
I'm getting a little more back of the attention now.
I enjoyed the running around, although yeah, my knees started to hurt, so I thought they were maybe I should stop. And it's just kind of nice just sort of walking and it's been sort of relaxing.
Okay,
kind of
to be
able to decompress that. Being able to kind of act the top of my game and the bottom of my game. It's been able to be a good release of real energy for me. And then just being in this space right now, it's been pretty a challenge to talk at the same time as somebody else right next to you. Having a hard time with that, but
also excited. I left work early today and I got to come here and spend time with some people I've never seen before, some people I have seen before, and this has been a much more interesting experience. And so now I get to talk. And I get to talk, and I'm not really that great at just talking on the phone. Okay. I prefer the exercises when we don't speak. Like I really like those exercises where we laid down and stood up and did the follow directions. I follow directions really well because that's what I was, you know, that's the generation I'm from. Like you give the directions and you follow.
I'm supposed to be talking.
And then, so it's really fun to do this sort of thing, walking
really
back
can't
and
say
forth.
Anything right now.
And I feel really.
You gotta sit down.
a lot of anxiety. Every time I do an acting exercise, it's really hard for me not to feel out of the circle.
That's walking back and forth and feeling the different feelings of whether your head is big or small, or you've got your game or you don't have your game. And I think about those things when I'm walking down the street, really. Sometimes you see somebody has a really cool walk and say, wow, I want to walk like that. So then you try it and say, wow, that's not really my walk. So they like to try out different walks.
God, it sucks to be on deck. It really gives us a way to talk. It's anxiety inducing. You should go.
I'm not
going to
go, but I don't think I'm going to say very much more.
It's really hard not to listen to you. I know I'm supposed to listen to you. I really want to pay attention to you. Sorry. Not sorry. I'm not sorry. You don't want me to pay attention?
No.
Yes or no?
No.
No. Okay.
You're just talking. Okay, next person.
So I was thinking about how I often think about stuff that I used to really pretend to be nervous, but when I was a teen and I came to understand college, I was like, I need to pretend to be nervous because everyone else is nervous and I'm not. And somehow in the last few years, I've actually started being nervous about things. So it feels like a really stupid reversal of circumstances, and I somehow just ended up inheriting everyone else's nervousness, and it just got sucked out of me, and I think that's silly. But for some reason, sometimes being yourself is the hardest thing to be. And that's really
I was really nice, really nervous, and I think I'm really soft, really nice, 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 really so
physical or playwriting or anything. Is a fascinating combination for me, and just trying to figure out, you know, there actually was an interrupt in the middle of my day that was actually fairly critical, and so almost pulled me out of the meeting. And so to be here and be able to move and sort of work through some of that was really cool for me. And how much I actually know the people in the room.
I came into this exercise thinking I would just be able to talk, but I don't really
know where they are.
And now what I'm wishing I did during the activity where we came out and we just stood and we could do anything for 2 minutes, I wish I'd come out and just looked at people, because just listening to her talk before it was my turn and kind of listening to everyone else talk, everyone was very interesting. She has some very interesting accessories that I enjoy a lot. And I wish I'd just come out and just observe people, because it would be interesting to know a little bit more about the people. And I gave a very convincing lie as to why I'm not there right now. And it's not valuable to my education at all. I can't stand that class. It's much more engaging.
We had a delicious lunch before, but I was feeling like it would be a really bad thing if I had two golden seats. So I chose to actually observe. One of the things that's really interesting about this is that people will be all trying to solve this solution on their own. They'll press through like zone defense and basketball. Everybody was off trying to do the entire task themselves. And people weren't teaming up to solve the problem. I found that fascinating. Another thing I noticed is was, when do you project yourself into the space and project what you need to do? And then when do you actually watch, when are you more present than watching than you're being actually.
And then we were walking across the stage. What I really wanted to do was look at people's faces all the time.
I really like to look at people's backs. The person's back in space is more interesting to me than a manufactured or elevated face. I also find that that there are times when sometimes it's really provocative, and that it's too long, and then it goes into a mathematical portion of the room, and it's time too long, then it makes it actually then more open. But I did quite enjoy the walking exercises. I felt very present in those.
So Nick, we need you to do your next turn.
So one of the things that I noticed is that the light is really special here. I kept wanting someone to be in the particular sweet spot in the space that would be under the light, because I can imagine how it would feel in the warmth, that would feel really good. And then I started thinking about how people determine what their choices are. And that sometimes they're really amazing.
Last night I was watching
external focus, is it internal? Sometimes it's really interesting to watch an internal focus when people are listening to a space, not just the looking at it. It's so high-centered. And then there's proportion too, and there are certain mathematically pure places in space, but it's really interesting to get transgressive and you like break the boundary. So those moments when you're seeing half a person, half in the space, out of the space. There are moments that it's just want to take a still of it. But other times it's really, it's a film thing, not a still.
Okay, let's stop. I'll go over and bring it back. Go over and listen to this. And reel them back in.
It's about to feel the tone of your voice. Just to hear how much air you're putting in.
Yeah.
And start to find that.
So I'm going to be doing a minute, and then I guess we'll see.
Getting closer by the minute, but I'm happy. Five. Oh yeah, we're good. We have almost.
So, John, Christina,
and then Linda and Jay. Do you want to come up too? All right. Jay, do you want me some? You know, I like to accommodate you. You're good. Okay. I forgot to say we were live streaming this as we live stream.
Oh no!
Oops! That was a major forget. Sorry about that, people.
Because they were on the elevator.
Yes. So we do that so to be aware that many people cannot join us. They cannot be in Boston, and we like the work that we do to be as accessible and transparent as possible. So. We live stream, we tweet out when we can, we just try to make it so that for events like this, as many people can participate. So, I just want to do kind of a brief question and answer. I had a great moment of, simpatico with Christina when she said when people come in and start asking to do actor exercises, I would like to leave the room immediately, and I felt deep, deep warmth for that.
That's what I felt when I was asked to do this workshop.
I know, right? Yes, exactly. That's what I mean. So here we all are stretching ourselves beyond what we normally do. So anyway, I just wanted to, I'll start it off with a question for you all, and then You know, maybe you can, and then I'll just invite other people to ask. You know, I asked a question yesterday, and I asked a question about when you feel like, as you're working and devising and making theater, when is a piece finished? And then, of course, I realized I got the response, you know, which is work is never done, which I know. But so that I know, it's never done. But when is the moment, like when, I mean, are you, is it, are you driven by when your date of performance is to be done? Or how do you sort of gestate the work? Or, you know, what's your process for sort of going, okay, this can go to an audience now? When is that moment? How do you know that moment?
Well, the cool thing about performance is you can't turn it in late.
Yeah. Yes. Any other thoughts? You don't have to have any thoughts.
Well, it's a little different, you know, as, I mean, as an actor, when you come in to a finished script, well, not completely finished, because we did a lot of, there was a lot of editing when, in the rehearsal period. So it is about the deadline, really, you know. And opening night is just terrifying. I just worked on one of the other New York City Players piece where Rich had a commission for the Whitney Biennial. And we went in there, took over the fourth floor of the Whitney Museum in New York, and developed a new piece. And that was really nice for all of us. It was exhausting because it was a huge space and 10,000 people came through during that week. And you don't realize what that, you know, it's exhausting. You know, just you just feel it the next day. But that was okay. What was interesting was there was a certain amount of pressure that was off of us, off of all of us, you know, including the writer and the director, Rich. At the same time, we were under this lens where we were being watched constantly. And I recognized the difference there between having to be on my game, I guess, you know, for opening night and being able or being given the privilege. And in fact, it looks like we're going to turn that piece, that's what that piece is going to be. We're just going to keep working on it in museums if we can, you know, around different cities and develop. You know, we just continued to develop, which is really what happens when we were in rehearsal. The edits Christina made were just so admirable because you see something and it's so well written, in my opinion, and you're learning all the lines, and then all of a sudden she cuts out like two pages, and it's like she cut out of, you know, my heart. But it was her work, you know, and for her to be able to do that under pressure, I think, is just remarkable. So I don't know if I answered your question.
No, it's great. It's great. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, go ahead, Matthew.
Does the writing, is it fluid with your sort of approach? In that, does the approach that you're sort of sharing, which I know is just a teeny bit, you know, affect the writing? And is also the writing connected to specific people because you are a company that's working in such a way? Do you know what I mean? Like, is there a fluid process between the writing and the... I can try and be more articulate, but I don't know if
I think I know what you mean. I think the writing is a little different. There's a lot of feeling, a lot of emotion, a lot of showing in the writing that doesn't come from the actors afterwards. And the idea is it's all in the writing, so you don't need to add anything else. So I'm not thinking about holding anything back or any kind of restraint or anything when I'm writing. Does that?
It does.
Specific people, yes, but not, yeah, I do think of. Well, the characters are based on specific real people, but then in the back of my mind, since casting is so hard, I am thinking about people that we've worked with before.
And does that sort of, does it, that affect how you, like, I'm really curious about how this value system would affect the creation process, this sort of sense about the, either the emptiness or the vulnerability and the emptiness or the aloneness, does that enter into when you're alone and writing? Because there's this, obviously, a dialogue going on. I'm curious about the dialogue.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think there's still the same I want the same openness in the writing so that there can still be, everyone can make of it what they want.
Yeah.
I don't think it affects the writing in any other way other than.
Right, okay, cool, thanks.
Howard.
For the New York City folks, City Players, I'm really interested in the relationship between the exercises that you just showed us, which were kind of fascinating, and the performance last night, which I loved. And I'm interested in how you would characterize, is the process completely about subtracting? Because clearly you had an accent and other elements that you actually added as well. So I'm curious what the balance is between actually finding active things or character elements that you're putting into the performance versus this idea of essentially taking almost all affect out of the performance and how those actually work in a rehearsal process. Or what the theoretical intention is.
My understanding, and I think it's not as codified as you would think it is, but I have been led to believe that my assignment is to not interpret, to give the text to the audience, to not fake anything, to acknowledge all of the punctuation that's written in the script, and there are a few other things.
All the articles.
Yeah.
Everything we have to do word for word, punctuation, follow it.
We can have an emotional experience, but we can't fake one.
Right. I think that sort of goes to what you're asking.
We can't have a private conversation because there's a room full of people, so we have to speak loudly enough for everyone to hear. We're not supposed to get locked into patterns. We're not supposed to go zombie. All of this adds up to an impossible task.
It's so hard.
Which, that's really what mm-hmm. you're doing when you're performing, is trying to do this and never succeeding.
What about characterization, like the accent?
It's just the writing. Well,
the accent, I mean, if you want to, the accent, if it's okay to talk about, was, I think, Christina wanted, and Rich was not too keen on, right?
Yeah, I really had to fight for the accent.
Yeah.
I mean, the accent is in the writing. It's in some of the spelling of the words. We tried it with actors without any accent at all, and it made no sense when I listened to it. I just couldn't. So I felt like that was sort of stretching this whole idea of performance to actually have an accent there as well.
But beyond that, there weren't many sort of characterization elements that were kind of popped into it or talked about. Is that right?
Right.
Okay, interesting.
It sounds a lot like martial arts. Mm-hmm. In a really interesting way,
sort of perfecting the imperfectible in form.
It reminds me of what Tadashi Suzuki do.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. It's constantly banging your head against something that you will never be able to achieve.
But he tells us that too. You know, like the point is not to get there.
Right.
You know, you're in the process, always in the process. So it's great because the rehearsals can be very difficult, and he can be very hard on us in rehearsals. But in the show, after the show, he always goes, "That was great," you know, because you know, so long as you're there in the moment, no matter what happens, no matter what you mess up, which I think in Rich's mind you can't mess up. You know, once you're there, you just see what you've got and go with it. You know. But I have to also say that, you know, I don't know if back-to-back theater has ever been to Boston, but they're a theater company from Australia, mostly comprised of autistic and, I don't know what the term we would use now, but not, I don't know if it's disabled. Anyway, they're mostly autistic Down syndrome adults. And I've seen them twice. The last time I saw them was just recently in New York. And I thought, oh my God, I mean, they can do that so easily, you know, because they have a detachment. So they, first of all, they're brilliant at memorizing pages, you know, no problem. So that they can memorize the words and just show up and present them without any work, you know, without it being difficult, because they have this behavior, if you will, not acquired, innate behavior of having some kind of detachment, for lack of a better word, you know, a distance from whoever they're talking to. So I learned so much when I watched them the second time. I thought, that's what he's asking us to do, you know, and we carry a lot more stuff. So the process to get there is very difficult. I mean, we've both, you know, performed for many years, and Anna Kohler, who's teaching at MIT now in theater here, said to me before I started rehearsals with this show, she said, this is going to be the biggest challenge of your career, to work with this guy. And she was right.
Yeah.
For LAPD, how do you guys, since you are in a very low-income environment, how do you bring education into your work? Is that one of your priorities to educate, or no? I guess would be a better question.
I would say one of our priorities is to educate Normalville. That is you guys, the rest of, you know, about the reality in Skid Row. So it's definitely a two-way street. We don't do any educational programs. You know, we work with adults. We do a lot of projects about, like the project we're doing right now is called Biggest Recovery Community Anywhere. I read in the New York Times a couple of years ago that Delray Beach was the biggest recovery community anywhere because there are a lot of pricey drug programs there. People go, they get clean and sober, they stay in the community, they feel comfortable, they open bookstores, coffee shops, and so there's a sophisticated recovery consciousness in Delray Beach. Well, there's the same sophisticated recovery consciousness in Skid Row because people get clean and sober there. They have the most affordable housing in Los Angeles County. They're not going anywhere. You know, I mean, some people do, but they stay there. They get jobs in the community. They start meetings in the community. So even though there are people, you know, in their addiction every day, they're confronted by, you know, 10 people who used to be in their addiction who are still living in the community who are no longer in it anymore. But to get that word out to the rest of Los Angeles when Skid Row is, you know, 5 blocks from City Hall and, you know, 2 blocks from where, you know, it's where the next billion-dollar real estate bonanza can happen if we could only get rid of the biggest recovery community. It's hard to get that word out, but that's what we're mainly focusing on. So our education is directed at the general public.
Yeah.
Okay. Andrea, go for it.
Well, they're very different because every project has its own, addresses different issues, and every project is really constructed to change the narrative about Skid Row and to get, you know, the information out about what Skid Row really is. So it depends. We, you know, this project about the biggest recovery community anywhere, we started thinking about the recovery community, but then as people came into the room and we started working, everybody had something to say about it. And, LAPD is like almost like a family. Even if people are new, there is a very big feeling of safety, and we're doing this together. Even if people walk in new, they don't sit on the side, they just jump in like you guys just did when we did the duologues. It's not about whether you are a brilliant performer or whether you are scared to say something, you just say something. And we work with that. And this, people are very supportive in that way. There's a whole culture of doing that. And so actually, people were very, became very personal about their own recovery and of their friends and their history. So this project is, we decided really to shape it about these stories because this is the heart of what recovery is about spiritual growth and knowing yourself and sharing and giving back to others and how that community is shaped. And that's what makes the community, all this wisdom of the people there. And so this is very much coming from improvisations, stuff like we were doing now, and people grab it, they just go with it. And it's very intense, the stuff that comes out, and we shape it into a performance. Just to show a little difference, you know, we just finished a performance that actually we worked on for 10 years, which was really about changing the narrative of the community, showing all the wonderful people that are in this community, that have made it a community, walk the talk. And so it has had different phases and different performances about gentrification and all these issues that have been coming up. And the last 1.5 years, we've really worked on rehearsing this performance. One of the things LAPD does, and it's maybe important to say, is we don't rehearse 3 months and then bam, there is the project. We make projects a year long, 9 months long at least. So, and the projects have very different phases. We work with the whole community. We don't have a rehearsal space. We don't have a theater. We work in different places in the community, and different phases of the project happen in different spaces. So the whole community gets involved, culminating in the final performance, wherever that is happening. And so, well, make it very short. We honored 36 people in the neighborhood. We interviewed all these people also publicly, so the whole neighborhood could be part of getting to know these people if they didn't already. And out of that, we created 36 scenes, which we performed on the streets in the places where those people lived or worked or still are working or created organizations. And so we ended up doing 3 days of parades last Memorial Day weekend with a brass band, and the police blocked off the street. So the whole neighborhood was really ours. We could finally walk in the middle of the street without getting tickets for jaywalking, which is what's happening in Skid Row, the only place in Los Angeles where jaywalking tickets are written for people who don't have any money. So that's how it works. You know, if you get your second ticket because you couldn't pay it, they can bring you to jail, and that's how they clean up the neighborhood. So, you know, the whole community was part of getting to know the history of the neighborhood, right? So every project has its own process and also has its own form.
Yeah, that project also had a public art element where we had actually Mr. Brainwash, if you've seen Exit Through the Gift Shop, he did 36 portraits of these people, and they were originally going to be put on lampposts in front of the spots where they associated with these people who are activists, artists, or people in recovery, people who've lived in the community, people who've worked in the community. We're so far, you know, like many public art projects, we ran into a lot of obstacles with politicians who didn't want to see the faces of their adversaries, out of the Catholic Worker, for example, immortalized on the street. And then it was actually funded by the Redevelopment Agency, which, after I voted for Jerry Brown and he got elected, he closed that down. So the 50,000 we needed to put them up vaped at that moment. So it's an ongoing, the public art process is still an ongoing thing, but anyway.
Yeah,
back there, yeah. I wonder if any of you had thoughts about the workshop of the others that you would like to share with us.
Well, it's always great, you know, just as art, individual artists, I think whenever we perform in a festival situation where we get to see, you know, companies that we know and actors that we know and companies and actors that we don't know. So I'm, you know, just fascinated with, and I've heard so much about LAPD, so it's just been great to be in the same room with them and just experience, you know, the differences and the similarities. You know, I think ultimately we're all about presenting ourselves, you know, to an audience and having some kind of exchange, and we do that all in different ways, and that's very exciting to me.
Yeah, I was just, yeah, for the same thing, and I just really enjoyed doing it. And I was just realizing when you were talking about we just want to get as close to being natural, to being real, that is very much how we work. And we work with people who are real. Mm-hmm. You know, the energy that drives them to perform, mm-hmm. it comes from a real place because they want to be part of it or they want to tell the story. Mm-hmm. And so I think to me is where we really touch. Mm-hmm. You know? I thought it was nice to hear. Explain about that.
Yeah, I think because I used to live in New York, you know, and wear black clothing, never rub off wet pizza. Stay out all night. And when I first ended up in Skid Row, you know, the passion and the urgency and the total lack of irony you know, is so refreshing and compelling, and that I got stuck there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, go ahead.
I have two questions. I'm just getting exposed to your work. So I was wondering, who are your performers? And I was also wondering if you've ever been afraid, especially in the early days of your work on Skid Row.
Well, the performers are people who live in the neighborhood.
They are.
Yeah, and you know, and naivete is one of the best things that you can have in your universe. And you know, so.
And look.
So you do things that you know that if you knew better you wouldn't do, or something like that. At the beginning of LAPD, I was researching on Skid Row, I thought, well, should I go hang out at a bar, you know, and find out, which would be like the original Hard Rock Cafe was there, right? Should I go hang out there to find out things, or should I go to a government hearing? I went to a government hearing, ran into the Catholic workers and all these advocates and the homeless people that were sounding off in front of the County Board of Supervisors. So that saved me, I would say. And from there, I really haven't been afraid. There's nothing, you know, nothing has ever jumped off that's been really a terrible incident.
And also, that is also because Skid Row, to me, being a foreigner and not being native to LA also, but having seen the different neighborhoods, Skid Row is the only place that feels like a neighborhood. Because people live on the street, and people know each other, and people look out for each other. I never have to be scared, because there's always somebody, you know, who will take care of me. But I actually, nothing has ever happened that I needed to be scared of. And that's also a special thing about Skid Row. Skid Row is not a gangbang neighborhood. There are no gangs. They're just really poor people who don't have money. And the people that sell the drugs come from outside, you know, to bring in the drugs. So it's a whole different, it's really like a community there.
Yeah. Andrea, and then Lisa, and then those will be the last two questions. So.
This is for both of you. What would you say, as your groups individually, is the best use or purpose of the theater? It's general, but.
What's the question?
In their personal opinions as groups, what is the best use of or purpose of the theater?
I feel we should open bourbon or something, or I don't know.
I think it's pretty straightforward. I mean, for me it is anyway. I think it's, and I think we probably have that in common too, is to allow an audience to see the world differently. You know, we don't use a lot of expression, and which is probably more conventional and something that doesn't require any thinking by an audience. But I think that we're basically saying, why is it normal to talk like this and have these intonations and go up when you ask a question? Like, why is that normal? How did that happen? And why are we taking that for granted, that that's okay? I mean, I'm speaking on a very basic, you know, non-emotional level, but it goes into that too, if you get deeper into it. So I think that's what it is. And it's also to, we really do give the audience a responsibility to engage, even though they're not speaking to us, but to take part in what's going on. In other words, to interpret it in the way they see fit, and because we're not going to tell them how to interpret what it is that we're doing. We don't feel that we don't feel that that's the right thing to do. You know.
What was your question again?
What would you say is, in your opinion, is the best use or purpose of the theater?
Well, I think two things. You know, one sort of in agreement is to, you know, is to confuse the categories, just to create a lot of confusion, which is good. And then the other thing I would say, which is maybe at odds with that, is to try and to try and locate your theater at a spot where it can have some impact.
that your play will be published?
Maybe published.
And that the follow-up to that, if it is published, then how do you, or would you write in how you would like the people who would be doing the show, how they would interpret that show? Is this work that you're doing going to be within that script? Does that make sense?
Yeah. No, I wouldn't write that in.
You wouldn't?
Yeah. It's just, I mean, it's already been done by other companies.
It has, okay.
Yeah.
So. Okay.
And have you seen those performances?
No, I haven't. Yeah. I've only seen pictures.
Did they do it in the same spirit, or did they?
I don't think so.
Based on the pictures?
Yeah.
Thank you all, and thank you for your generous time with us this afternoon. We really appreciate it, and we're so glad you're here. So thank you.
Thanks.
Very much. Yeah, it was great.
We're back here at 3 o'clock tomorrow for Double Edge Theater over here and the Universes.
So. All right. Thank you.
Okay.
Fantastic to see your show that.
Now until what?
Really.
I can't figure out what our show is.
I feel obligated.